Welcome to a special post-budget Tax Sutra hangout with the who's who of the tax world. From Mumbai, Rohan Shah of Economic Laws Practice, Gautam Doshi of Reliance. From Delhi, joining us, Mohan Parasaran, former Solicitor General, Mukesh Bhutani, BMR. And I won't waste any time in getting started. I think this sums it up all. The ET headline, it says, aiming for the goal, Modi hits the crossbar. Aiming for the goal, Modi hits the crossbar, superb. And without wasting any time, in 60 seconds, I'll ask my partner and colleague Amay to sum up the key direct tax and indirect tax proposals in the budget. Amay?
Arun, we of course heard about the change relating to the retrospective tax and the change relating to the transfer pricing. Two more changes in the direct tax would like to highlight. One is, of course, there is no word on the GAR deferral. So as the things stand today, GAR becomes effective from 1st of April 2015. Of course, he has one more budget to deal with GAR-related provisions. Second, CSR expenditure, the law as has been proposed now, specifically says that unless the expenditure is covered under Section 30 to 36, it shall not be allowed as a deductible expenditure under Section 37 if it is a mandatory CSR expenditure. This potentially will unsettle some of the existing jurisprudence in which corporates have claimed the so-called CSR expenditure. Coming to the indirect tax, again, two specific points would like to highlight. One is the mandatory fixed pre-deposit before filing an appeal before Commissioner Appeals and Tribunal. I think this seems to be contrary against the intent of reducing the litigation that Finance Minister announced. Introduction of the 30% interest if there is a delay in payment of service tax beyond 1 year. Of course, this is to ensure that there's a strict compliance, but 30% rate seems to be very high. Arun?
Yeah, absolutely. I'll start with Rohan Bhai. Rohan Bhai, if you could go first and each one of our panelists could take us through in, say, 90 seconds, your hits and misses, your positives and negatives from the budget, and then we'll come to all the individual issues. Rohan Bhai, we'll start with you.
Yeah. So, quite clearly, one of the misses from my perspective is the fact that even while he is purported to deal with this issue of the retrospective amendment, he just has not dealt with it in any manner which offers any definitive guidance in terms of how the past issues, which were the issues which were really causing the negative sentiment, are to be dealt with. To say that they will have their own destiny before the courts, I don't think is any sort of intervention of the type that could have been hoped for. The second situation, which I think was something of a miss, is that given the importance of GST and given the level of expectation, a deadline, some sort of a deadline, even if it were the 1st of April 2016, is something that I think should have been out there just in terms of the messaging. We know that much of the work has been done, some remains, and you have to give a transition to industry to move into the GST itself. In terms of what he's got right, I think tonally, the budget, renews hope, it reaffirms hope. A lot of good things have happened around the transfer pricing. There seems to be a genuine attempt to try and dilute the potential areas of conflict and litigation. At the same point in time, he is not fully thought through the consequences of what was just mentioned. In trying to reduce litigation on the indirect tax side, he has said, I will do away with the dealing of stay application. Appellate authorities will not deal with stay application. Section 35F is out. The consequence of that is that you have to make this statutory pre-deposit. A statutory pre-deposit, I don't think you can assail on constitutionality, but the worry is that in an area of time and in a period where there are such large adventurous demands, what is the consequence for an assessee? He has to compulsorily make a payment in a situation where somebody is on a frolic raising hundreds of crores of demand. So you have taken away litigation as a factor of facilitation for assessee, but by increasing the cost of what the assessee has to bear. So these are some of the points. I'm sure my colleagues have many more.
Gautam Bhai?
I think what Rohan has, of course, summed it up very well. What we are really saying is we've expected clarity on a number of areas, but there are internal inconsistencies also. Take, for example, the whole idea that at least on retro tax, the only guarantee we have is that this government will not do retro tax. But the small amendment which he has made on capital gains is effectively retrospective. Because what he says is, if you have invested earlier and in 12 months or 24 months you encash your mutual fund or unlisted equity shares, then you would effectively now pay short-term capital gains and you will not be entitled to indexation. I don't think that could be intended. If the law is to be amended and prospectively, it should apply to investments made after 10 July. That would be quite logical, that an investment made today or hereafter will be liable to short-term gains, and that's what you know. You make your investment to weaponize, not otherwise. So that's one. Also, while the overall tone is very clearly investor-friendly, assessee-friendly, the whole idea is that we want to settle with assessees rather than fight with them, you still have minor tinkering like the dividend distribution tax, converting it from net to gross and increasing the percentage by 2 or 3%. If at all it had to be dealt with, it had to be dealt with far more holistically. You had to have a situation, because you can't ask small assessees whose overall rate of tax is not even 10%, because average on 5 lakhs would come down to 5%, to pay as much as 22 or 20, 21% tax on their dividend income, because that's what you're really asking them to pay. The huge tax which you are asking small assessees to pay, you are effectively shutting them out of the equity market. You are saying don't enter the equity market. But those are the people you want them to enter. I think the correct solution would have been for these assessees, reduce the DDT to maybe even 5% or 10%, and say that for any assessee earning more than 50 lakhs or 1 crore dividend, it will be included in his normal income. He will pay full tax at 30%. The net result would be more or less the same. Government would perhaps get almost the same revenue, but by a provision which would be fairer between the two. As Amay said, maybe there was not enough time to think through how to achieve what one wants to achieve. And therefore, while the approach is right, the route adopted does not seem to be absolutely right.
The perfect. Dr. Amay, we'll quickly get Mukesh Bhai and Mohan sir's comment. Mukesh Bhai.
Well, I think if we look at the budget headlines, I mean, he really seems to attempted to take care of all constituencies. So what has happened is that, firstly, there's more in the hands of pocket of a common man. He tried to tick all the right boxes. Obviously, you have a new government coming in, and the people who voted them in power are the first constituents, in my view. So really, corporates are secondary. He's accepted the challenge on sticking to fiscal deficit. You know, this is predicated on 17% growth in tax collection, a 99,000 crore non-tax revenue, which he has not explained possibly could be out of spectrum licenses, and 63,000 out of divestment. On tax regulations, I think the biggest item is easing of transfer pricing regime. On retrospective tax, I take the views expressed by Gautam Bhai and Rohan, but I think he had a big rider. He said it in the speech very clear. Retrospectivity is a sovereign right. I think that signaled his desire, or indirectly, that he's going to do only things that he would like to do, being risk averse, insofar as the retrospective tax amendment is concerned. So I know that there was widespread expectation that this government, in order to ease doing business and assuage the sentiments of foreign investors, will take away the retrospective, but that has not happened. Now one needs to wait and see. I think the larger message is that, in my view, this is a preparatory exercise for larger reforms to kick in. We were just on a debate at the Big Fight half an hour back as to why was he implementation date. Now the larger challenge that he seems to be facing on GST implementation, assuming that he's able to get states on board and he's able to agree the compensation formula, is whether he will be able to get past the constitutional amendment, given the strength that he has on the floor of the parliament in both the houses. So it will be extremely embarrassing for this new government, which has come with a thumping majority, not to get past a constitutional amendment. So I think that's his larger worry. And I think until unless he gets to a level of comfort that the constitutional amendment will go through, he cannot announce a definitive date. I think there are several measures to promote infrastructure, the specific taxation regime for REITs, infrastructure investment funds, classifying all forms of bonds, applying the 5% withholding tax rate, whether they're infrastructure or non-infrastructure related, the investment allowance for threshold, bringing it down from 100 crore to 25 crore, in my view, is a boost to medium and small enterprises. So I think there is kind of a lot in the budget for everyone. Some people ask me, well, what did he do about the Tax Administrative Reforms Commission? It's a 594-page document that was submitted just in the first week of June. I presume by that point in time, the entire budget writing exercise would have been over. But if you look at some of the things that he has done with respect to addressing the environment on tax litigation, whether that is expanding the scope of AAR to have domestic transactions or having additional benches, or for that matter, revamping the entire settlement commission procedure for both custom excise and for income tax. I think he's picked up several leaves from the TARC report, because this is precisely what went in the TARC report. So I think
Mukesh bhai, if I can come to a couple of specifics, with Mohan sir. Mohan sir, if you can quickly give your overall take, and then I want your specific take on retro amendment, what he did. You batted for doing away with it and not this, but you also left a hint, maybe what the government may do is to not contest it in the courts at all. So in a way, you are undoing it by not doing anything. Number one. And number two, on the AAR, Mohan sir, you've been quite a harsh critic on the way AAR has functioned. So your overall take on the budget tax proposals, and then specifically on retro amendment and the AAR, Mohan sir.
See, as I told you, Arun, the finance minister did not have much time. And as Mukesh pointed out, within the available time, he has sought to deal with almost every aspect and has mainly addressed the issues primarily of a common man and generally all issues. But there have been several looping gaps. And in fact, during his speech, he said many issues will be addressed in Part B of the budget. But when we saw the fine print, they are all absent. And we have already discussed many issues now. And qua the retrospective amendment, I am quite disappointed. The finance minister made the intentions of the government very clear. He said the sovereign government has the right to tax retrospectively. And he also said it is not proper to actually levy a retrospective tax, in the sense that you can't seek to tax transactions like Vodafone. Virtually, we made such a statement, meaning the amendment which was brought about by the previous government was bad. If you had gone to that extent, what was the need for appointment of another committee when the previous government had appointed the Parthasarathi Shom committee, which had gone into in great depth and had given its recommendations? And when matters are sub judice, with the statement made by the finance minister, what can now the government do before the high courts where the matters are pending? The concerned law officers will have no other go in the light of the statement made by the finance minister to just go and concede the cases. Instead of making that concession, the government could have very well done away with the retrospective amendments in this budget exercise and made Section 9 and some other sections prospective. That is my view.
Mohan sir, on the AAR.
With regard to the AAR, what I feel is you must actually first create institutions which can effectively function. You must create confidence amongst the litigant public. And we know how the AIRs functioned in the past. Lack of infrastructure, physical, number one. And number two, appointment of people who did not have sufficient actual expertise in fiscal and taxation matters, and giving judgments which were directly contrary to the law declared by Supreme Court. As a consequence of which, actually, many foreign investors lost confidence in the AIR and desired to go by the normal route, or straight away, actually, after the decisions, they had to go and slog before the high courts. And now, if you are going to actually have this AIR expanded, you must have actually competent men to man the AIR. You can't just create benches. Therefore, I strongly feel, I think we need to find competent men of substance and create confidence first, and then actually go ahead. Possibly the finance minister will be having something up his sleeves.
Yeah. Can we go to Rohan Bhai? Am I a specific question for Rohan Bhai?
Rohan Bhai, two specific questions. One on the GST. I think while GST actual implementation will take time, finance minister had some opportunity to take a step forward in terms of aligning the existing laws, be it SINVAT credit especially. Do you think he could have done better on this, or do you think the amendments that have come, that have been proposed, especially on the service tax and SINVAT, are they in the right direction as far as the GST implementation is concerned? And second question, Rohan Bhai, is on the fate of the fiat ruling. We've seen so many circulars, clarifications being issued. Do you think an amendment in the law itself to clarify the government's intent vis-a-vis fiat ruling would have been helpful?
Yeah. Let me first take the issue of GST, right? Three cornerstones of GST really would be, one is that you have a unitary tax at a unitary rate, so a single rate and a single tax. The second situation would have been that every event of a commercial transaction suffers tax. And the third would have been that every preceding tax paid effectively results in a full credit. Now, from that perspective, what you would have possibly thought he could have done is that if the rate that we are talking about for GST is going to be 16%, then some might have suggested that he should have inched up the rate to cause a transition towards the 16%. He possibly could have done that, but he also had his own compulsions in terms of the state of the economy and the manufacturing sector. So I don't think I would critique him for that. The second thing you need in terms of uniform rate is a complete elimination of exemptions. There again, he has eliminated some exemptions. He has brought in a few more. And I think that, again, is part of the current economic compulsions in terms of what he could or he could not do. So on that, I would not fault him. The other issue, of course, is the whole situation in terms of credit. Do you bring in a culture where every rupee of tax paid ultimately results in a credit? And there I have an issue, and there I believe is a missed opportunity, because there could have been a further rationalization of the SINVAT credit rule to make them much more robust in terms of SINVAT credits. The other thing which he has done, which I think is actually retrograde, is that he has now said that unless you take your SINVAT credit within 6 months, you will effectively lose that credit. Now, that provision actually runs counter to a line of judgments, including the Ram Swarup judgment of the Allahabad High Court. If you are moving to GST, and if, as part of that move, you have to make the credit mechanism more robust, this sort of a provision is retrograde, because once tax is paid, you should give credit irrespective of time frame. And there is no rationale why, even contrary to judgments, you should restrict this to 6 months. Coming to your other issue in terms of fiat, you know, my sense is that that judgment was just so off the wall that the government has really felt compelled in every manner to sort of try and address it. And, you know, they've done enough now, I would believe, to get the message across to the tax administration that as long as on an arm's length basis you sell below the cost of production, that is something which must be accepted. So could more have happened? Could different have happened? I think the message has gone enough strong enough, and I don't think anybody would be trying to administer that part of the law contrary to what the clear intent now is.
Gautam bhai, quickly I'll come on two issues to you, and then I would like y'all to chat up with each other on any thing y'all feel is quite important. But Gautam bhai, number one on GST, very quickly, apart from what Rohan bhai said, don't you feel a little heartened that the finance minister is putting so much at stake? He's literally putting his prestige at stake on the GST. He's gone out on one limb in the speech, in every interview he's given after the speech, that he wants to see GST, and he says the time has come to end the debate. This is what he told CNBC, that we should end the debate definitively. Gautam bhai, doesn't that give you some hope? And number two, on CSR, do you actually agree with what the memorandum says? It says that the CSR expenditure, being an application of income, is not incurred for the purposes of carrying on business. Such expenditures cannot be allowed under the existing provisions of Section 37 of the Income Tax Act. Gautam bhai.
Yeah, taking the second one first, as far as CSR is concerned, I think I would agree with the finance minister. I can't see how CSR is business expenditure. And in fact, though the explanatory memorandum says that if the expenditure falls between 30 to 36, it will be allowed. Frankly, I doubt even that. Because if it is not for the purpose of business, it doesn't matter. Even if it falls within, if say it's a repair expenditure, how would it be allowed under 30 or 31? It's not a repair for the purpose of business. And if it is not for the purpose of business, just because it is repair, it won't get allowed under 31. So even that part of the explanatory memorandum, I think, is not really correct. It won't get allowed. And certainly what they have said on 37 perhaps sets out the law as it is meant to be. I think if you want to do charity, do it from your pocket. Don't do it from government's pocket by asking government to pay 30% of it, or whatever percentage you want to ask government to pay for it. Or otherwise, don't do it. Will corporates deal with it in some way or the other? Yes. For example, the simplest is therefore not to do CSR, to do something as part of the business, and then justify that in the director's report, saying, because our business already involves so much which is, let us say, encouraging green energy, we are not doing 2% CSR. So now you will get a deduction, your shareholders will be happy, and the whole thing will work. But as the law stands, I think he's right. It is not really allowable. Turning back to GST, I think he had no choice but to at least make this commitment. But I don't think the commitment has come in as strongly, as effectively as one would have expected it, at least in Parliament. Yes, it has come across in the subsequent interviews. But in his speech in Parliament, I don't see it, the commitment being of the same strength. It could have been much stronger. It could have been far more clearer. Some issues of what is holding it up, what is government's thinking on those unitary rates, how is the government approaching it, it could have been a little better.
Yeah.
But I'm Mukesh, sure he has enough time to do it in the next few months.
Yeah, Mukesh bhai and Mohan sir, I want both your comments on one issue, which is DTC. Mukesh bhai, if we can see you in the frame, we can't see you in the frame. Mukesh bhai, your comment on the DTC, that is one issue on be it the speech or be it the interviews. He is non-committal. The best he came to answering that was to a TV channel when he said that 45 days, I have not had the time to look at DTC. When I get the time, I will, and then we will review. Mukesh bhai, what does that mean?
Well, I think what I was expecting is a clear statement whether he is going to get rid of DTC or he is going to proceed with the DTC. So I think he's answered that question. He could have easily said that we don't need DTC. Many of the out-of-box thinking on new laws have already been incorporated, including the draft GAR law, which is going to be effective from April 2015. He didn't say that. So I think he's saying that DTC is on cards, but given the fact that it has gone at least through three detailed iterations, including two reviews by the Standing Committee on Parliament, I don't know what he's going to do next. Now, it is debatable, and I don't think that it is right or wrong whether we should or we should not have DTC. I've spoken to many, many people in the industry. some people feel that we are going to have a modern regime, a new law, unclutter the entire income tax law of 1961, and we need a new regulation. Most people who are reluctant to have DTC believe that all the jurisprudence that has been laid down by the High Court and Supreme Court, particularly the Supreme Court, will go all waste. Because I recall one of the statements that Finance Minister Pranab Mukherjee made was that if DTC comes into effect, the old jurisprudence will not apply. Now, that didn't make any sense to me because, you know, it's like saying that the jurisprudence articulated as in the 1922 Income Tax Act will not apply to 1961 Income Tax Act. So correct me, sir, if I'm wrong, but I think that statement did send a lot of nervousness in the minds of taxpayers, and they felt that we are better off not to have a DTC and still live with the 61 law, because at least there is some degree of jurisprudence that will guide us. What's going to happen, I don't know, but I think what is certain is that this government seems to be looking at implementing the DTC. Would it mean another fresh review? Would it mean cleaning up? Would it mean going back to the first principles and looking at issues such as profit-based incentive versus capital-based incentive, relooking at the entire GAR? But I think besides thin capitalization, there is nothing which is not there in the 1961 Income Tax Act. I'm not going to say whether we need it or we don't need it. Let's leave that open for the finance minister to debate. But what is important is to signal a definitive date by which DTC will come in. And the principles are exactly similar as in the case of GST. Is it April 1, 2015 or is it April 1, 2016? I think that is something which in my view is missing currently from the statements that he made yesterday.
Mohan sir?
See, I would put it like this. See, in the past, many finance ministers have been giving timelines or milestones which have never been achieved. And as far as this finance minister is concerned, he is not only a very, very shrewd administrator, but one of the greatest strategists amongst the lawyers. Therefore, he has kept everything under his sleeves and possibly he did not want to make any commitments. And as time progresses, I think he will come out with his definitive statements. What is the purpose of just actually giving some statements and timelines if you are not able to achieve that? And that's why even qua GST, as Mukesh pointed out, we still are facing problems from the constitutional perspective. He would have understood the difficulties of the numbers in Rajya Sabha. And Rajya Sabha, I think the target is 2016. So possibly after 2016, I think they'll give a push for the GST.
Sir, can't we have a joint session of Parliament where a GST constitutional amendment bill can be pulled through with two-thirds majority?
The problem is our country, you let me frank, no? It's all a game of politics. You don't go by objectivity. So it's all a question of numbers. What a government, well, BJP, when it was ruling, may have a particular stand. When it's the opposition, it will have a different stand. Likewise, Congress. See, unless and until I think parties look at things objectively in the progress of the nation, I think we will never proceed in the interest of the nation. Therefore, I think these are factors which might be weighing with the finance minister.
Arun, I just came out in a debate where we had Manish Tiwari and N.K. Singh, both representing the Congress and the BJP. And the issue was about the date for implementation and a political consensus. And my comment, which turned out to be a provocative comment, was let's not politicize the issue of GST rollout because all political parties seem to agree. And to that, Manish vehemently disagreed and said, just because we were ruling and we were supportive of GST and the current government was not supportive, we will have to wait and see. I think he put it in a very diplomatic manner, but to me it seems GST is a political issue, at least insofar as the rollout with respect to a constitutional amendment is concerned, because you cannot push your way to GST without that amendment.
Yeah, we'll quickly get Rohan Bhai because he has to rush, I know, for some engagement. Rohan Bhai, I do want to have your, before your closing remarks, Rohan Bhai, on the service tax, are you happy with the with what he said yesterday? He said that he's going to prune the negative list. He doesn't think service tax, if you go by his 2012 speech, which we ran in our series Retro Rewind, he did not feel service tax negative list was a good move at all. So you think on the service tax, the right message has been sent by Mr. Jaitley yesterday, and your closing remarks, Rohan Bhai.
Look, if he has to move to a GST, then he has to prune the negative list, because he has to ensure that virtually every transaction which takes place commercially does suffer a tax in the nature of an indirect tax. So really, I have no critique of that. In terms of closing comments, I would actually like to A, leave one comment, and B, pose a question to Mr. Parasaran. Let me first pose that question to Mr. Parasaran. Mr. Parasaran, you know, given this thing in terms of where we are today on the retrospective amendment, where he said that the cases which are pending in court must play themselves out, what intrigues me is, as finance minister, what sort of instruction will he give his law officers in terms of what he should do in court? If he tells them to defend these demands and this provision, he's really signaling a support for what has happened. If he, in fact, says, no, concede these situations, then was the easier route not to do it in some other manner rather than to concede matter after matter in court? Just wanted to get your views on that.
That's why I think possibly has cleverly recused himself of Vodafone, giving a reason that Vodafone were once his clients, no? But but I feel the government will tell the law officers, I think, to play it by the ears.
That really means very little, right? because they will have to stand up and say something in court. And that day is not far away, that the series of these matters.
But the minister made it quite clear, I think, from what I heard yesterday. I think he made the intentions quite clear that the amendments were, I think, quite oppressive. And once such a solemn statement has been made in parliament, I think the lawyers for the petitioners, like Mukesh, are not going to leave them. They are going to rip apart.
You know, Rohan, the answer to your question by Mr. Parasaran is even more diplomatic than the answer the finance minister has given in the budget on retrospective amendment.
Absolutely, absolutely. And in that spirit of diplomacy, let me withdraw from the panel and thank all of you.
Any closing remarks, Rohan?
Look, you know, in terms of closing remarks, I must say that as opposed to the sort of sentiment that I personally felt over the last 3 or 4 years, after this budget, I do still feel a sense of hope. I feel a sense of affirmation. I believe there are good things to look forward to. And what I'm really counting on is not issues like the budget, but the factor of good governance across this very wide spectrum of issues that he has taken up, many of which will be very beneficial to the nation if they are actually implemented. And what I'm seriously hoping is that if that sort of governance of quality comes through, then hopefully at the end of 3 or 4 years of good governance, we won't spend so much time discussing the budget. If we get there, that I think would be the real achievement that we will have as a nation. So thank you very much, all of you.
Thank you, Rohan.
Thanks, Rohan.
Thank you.
Before we get Mukesh Bhai on transfer pricing, and I may ask some specific questions on TP to both Mukesh Bhai and Mohan sir. Gautam Bhai, Mr. Jaitley has done what you wanted him to do. I think basically what you wrote, that you delegate the power to a committee and let the committee decide. So at least Gautam Bhai, you have to be happy. You think he's done what you expected?
No, I'm not really sure that he's delegated the power to a committee. I really want to wait and see what he is giving to the settlement commission. And is he going to give sufficiently wider scope to the Settlement Commission that even this retro tax matters could be dealt with by them, whereby, let's say, at least those assessees who are willing to pay the tax can escape the interest in the penalty, because that's a power which is already vested in the Commission. And in that form, indirectly provoke settlements and therefore bring to an end the disputes of the past. And by through the committee, make sure that no new disputes arise in respect of the past. But I think along with that, the minimum I was also expecting was clarity on some of these amendments. Like, what is an indirect transfer? I think that is an area where, at least if you had brought in the Shom committee's recommendations, that should have really been useful and helpful.
Right. Mukesh bhai.
Yes.
Arm's length margin approach, he's moving away to a range-based approach. That change also will require a change in the law and not just change via rules. There has been a litigation which seems to have settled down on this particular issue based on the current point of law. So one specific question is, do you think that the change in the law is required, or can he bring out this change only via rules? And second point, one of the concerns that was expressed, especially during the BEPS discussion, was whether the current government will fast track any of the proposals, especially on the country by country reporting documentation. Do you see that proposal sort of being considered by the government and may come through in the coming months?
Well, I think let me answer the last question first, whether the government will do anything to supplement the country-by-country reporting as a part of the BEPS initiative. I hope the government does not do it, because what BEPS is trying to achieve is putting down a set of framework agreements on various action points that it has, and India is a signatory to that. So I think if any government, leave alone India, tries to put something in its domestic law, it will defeat the very purpose of framework agreement, number one. Number two, if you look at the draft OECD on country by country reporting, the most amount of criticism has been on that particular action point. So wherein, you know, the BEPS eventually is going to come out with a country by country reporting, which is going to look at much more diluted than what the first format suggests. So I just hope that the Indian government does not push the horse before the cart. To your first two questions, yes, you are correct. Reading from the fine print, it suggests to me that in order to bring the range concept, which is internationally called the interquartile range concept, he will have to amend the law. A simple amendment to Rule 10 shall not suffice. But I think this is something that they will get, it will get picked up before the bill goes through a formal president's accent. The two other points that I wanted to make in relation to transfer pricing was, one was on the rollback provision. I think it's a fantastic move. I think it will not just help manage litigation for people who are APA aspirants for 5 years before the APA, but even to the extent cases are lying before the tribunal, and I'm just presuming most of the matters before are factual issues and they are not lying before the High Court or the Supreme Court, these issues could also get settled. Because let's assume that a matter for assessment year 3, 4, 4, 5, 5, 6, which is not covered by the rollback provision, comes up before the tribunal. I'm sure that the tribunal will take a pragmatic view, besides, of course, interpreting the law. And if the taxpayer has a APA, and now with a legislatively backed rollback provision, it could help settle many disputes which are lying before the tribunal, number one. It could also help settle disputes which are lying before the competent authorities. As you know, that the India-US APA program has been put on break primarily because the United States feels that India has not done much to settle the 300 odd MEP applications. So I think this just augurs well for everyone, from the government from the point of view of disposal of appeals for tribunals who will have now guidance for assessing officers who can use the statutory provision, and more importantly for the taxpayers. So I think this is a very, very good move that they have done on rollback of APA provisions.
Yeah. Mohan sir, specifically coming to one transfer pricing issue where you were involved and you saved the blushes for the government, the share valuation one. Would you have expected something in the budget
yes.
on that? If you are saying that you want to give absolute clarity, tax clarity to foreign investors, then why wouldn't, as Gautam Bhai had suggested pre-budget, why wouldn't you just clarify and say that no, we are not going to tax it, Mohan sir? Is it maybe not as simple as I am making it out to be?
See, the government, as a matter of policy, could have done that. But if they did not want to even go anywhere near retrospective amendments, why should they go near this, I say? This is also being seriously contested. Therefore, possibly, I think the finance minister, as a matter of policy, did not want to tinker with the act where matters were hotly contested and where it was sub judice.
Yeah. Nah.
Mohan sir and Mukesh and Gautam Bhai, just one small observation on the retrospective point. He has made a specific statement during the speech that this government will not bring
ordinarily will not bring any
retrospective change which creates a new liability. I'm sure you would have noted a small change in the rule in the indirect tax relating to the pan masala rules, where the change has actually been brought out with a retrospective effect from April 2010.
Yeah.
It's a small provision, but something which I found interesting.
Absolutely. You know, I think most of the big issues we've dealt with, but I have something very different, not really related to the budget. When you have a finance minister, Mohan sir, who's making statements like we'll
yeah.
give certainty, I don't believe in this amendment, and so on and so forth, what happens to the morale of the law officer who has to go there and defend some of those tough tax positions in the court? Forget the retro amendment cases, but even generally, tomorrow, if a case like Vodafone comes up, what do you say? You know, what does a law officer go and argue when he knows that probably the government itself, heart in heart, is not backing him? Does it affect the morale of the law officer, Mohan sir?
What I would actually read is that, see, as we discussed, there is a retrospective amendment in this budget, qua capital gains tax, qua pan masala. There the morale of the law officers will be very high. When it comes to Vodafone, the morale, I think, will not be that high. Therefore, it all depends upon case to case. And as far as Vodafone is concerned, it stands on a different footing. There's a Shrum Committee report. Even the morale of the UPA law officers were not very high, except possibly Mohan Parasaran. Therefore, we'll wait and see, I say. And
Gautam Bhai,
ultimately,
as
Gautam Bhai was pointing out, the committee, I think, will have to take a tough call. No? They'll negotiate. Vodafone agreed to actually pay the taxes. It's a question of whether they are also liable to pay penalty and interest. Let us actually get some money from them, I say. And this committee, I think, can be used for that purpose, and the law officers need not be embarrassed. No?
Gautam Bhai, are we really coming back to a stage when you see such statements being made that we are firmly and definitively back into the era of Westminster, which is what Vodafone laid down? Today, India, Westminster is the law of the land. Is that clear?
Yep. But with a car on the side, there is no Westminster left, isn't it? GAR is a complete answer to it, and GAR is just 1 year away. Again, we need clarity on GAR. We need it to be modified. We need it to become clearer. I think what we really want is both, even on Vodafone, I'm saying more than the retrospectivity, even prospectively, unless that law is made reasonable, what we have is something which is really going too far. You can't really charge a portfolio transfer on New York Stock Exchange and hope to collect tax on that. How are you ever going to do that? And that's really what your loss is.
Yeah.
So we do need...
Yeah. Amit, a quick trivia to you. we compiled a number of case laws overruled by by the amendment yesterday. How much would that count come to?
I think the current count is about at least 25 judgments from tribunal and high court. We are still going through some of the other provisions and few old laws, old cases. So
yeah.
Current count is 25.
And in 60 seconds, any other key issues that we would have left out of discussion, which you think you would like to make a mention?
This retrospective change again, which is the flavor of the day for sure. He specifically touched upon the indirect transfer related issues. The Finance Bill 2012 also introduced several retrospective changes.
Almost two dozen.
Specifically on the royalty and FTAs, he brought in the change with retrospective effect from 1976. I think some clarity, some word on this would have been really helpful, Arun. Mukesh Bhai, but would be happy to hear your thoughts whether the indirect transfer framework will also apply to some of these other retrospective changes.
Yeah, and then we could go for closing comments, starting from Mukesh Bhai, Mohan sir, and then Gautam Bhai.
I have not read the fine print, but I'm also told that several tribunal decisions are being overridden as a result of changes that the finance minister has proposed in the bill yesterday. But I think that, and I'm hearing this debate on retrospective amendment, he very clearly said about retrospectivity being a sovereign right. So I don't know whether it is fair to be able to, put the blame on him or put any kind of a prohibition that the government cannot introduce a retrospective law. I think what is important to debate is that if a retrospective law comes into effect, one, does it really go to clarify the intent of the law? To what extent it is reasonable? And we all know that the virus of a retrospective amendment can always be tested in the court. That's the first part of it. The second part of it is a point that Gautam Bhai was making. Having legislated a retrospective law, is it administrable? I think that's really the challenge that we had in the context of 2012 amendment. Retrospective laws historically have been a norm. Yes, the incidence of that has increased in the last past few years. But what happened in 2012 was an event that kind of, had shaken up the confidence of the business, because you are really amending a law which was going against a well-debated trial that was finally settled by the Supreme Court. And two, you now bring out a law which you cannot administer. Like Gautam Bhai was saying, if you read the law today, even a portfolio investment that, a change in a portfolio investment that occurs virtually every second in an overseas stock exchange means it triggers off that law. So I think we need to bring some context to this debate of retrospective law. One, that it's a sovereign right for the government to legislate the law. Two, that right can be challenged in a court of law. And three, if you have that law, can you actually administer it?
Perfect. Mohan sir, 30 seconds closing remarks. Mohan sir, we'll quickly wind up.
I fully agree, but what, as Gautam Bhai said, the government should have shed more light, no? Yes, they could have made it prospective. And even while making it prospective, they should have tinkered with several of the drastic amendments brought about. Otherwise, see, all sorts of transactions which should not be taxed will be in the taxing.
Perfect.
See, the government tried to overreach by these amendments. And okay. I have been repeatedly saying, the written submissions given by the law officers were virtually part of the amendments. Written submissions of Mr. Nariman, which was rejected by the Supreme Court, not only the review petition, but also in the curative petition, was cut and pasted for the first time by the Parliament.
Perfect. Gautam Bhai, 20 seconds, Gautam Bhai. Overall, happy with the budget?
Yeah, overall happy. And what I'm seeing really is, like in the Settlement Commission, Transfer Pricing Advance ruling, I think amendments are an ongoing process. They are not stopping with the budget. And perhaps all these issues, you have an open government which is perhaps going to listen to you, and maybe to the extent that they need to make changes, they will perhaps make changes even elsewhere. And if that is true, then really we are okay.
Thank you so much, Gautam Bhai. Thank you so much, Mohan, sir, Mukesh Bhai and Rohan Bhai who left earlier. Thanks so much for this post-budget hangout and thanks, Amay. I think it was an exciting 45 minutes for all of us. Thank you and we will be back with Union Budget 2015 in less than 7 to 8 months' time. Thank you.
Thank you, Gautam Bhai. Thank you, Arun.
Thank you, Gautam Bhai. Arun, Amay,
thank you. Thank you.
So I have to...